If it looks like we lost all composure and pride, if it feels like we laid our restraints aside, we seem desperate, it's just 'cause it's true. If you're looking for a city, for a place to show your glory, look no further, we're available. If it sounds like your kingdom's all we're talking about, if it sounds like we're tuned all the noise out, we're just listening for you. Our praise and our prayers seem outrageous and bold. If our worship gets too big for this building to hold, we're not making a show, we're just making room. If you're looking for a city, for a place to show your glory, look no further. Look no further, we're available.
This morning, anybody awake out there? Come on, anybody awake? Shout for Jesus. So if you are a visitor with us, thank you for coming. We appreciate you being here. You have came on an absolutely great day, because today is the day we get to honor our pastor and his wife, Pastors Dale and Teresa Buchanan. It is Pastor Appreciation Day, and listen, if you've never been here or you've been here a couple times, we have the best pastors ever, ever. We are truly, truly blessed here at Rio East. So what I have today is a song. I'm going to have Eddie play it here in just a second, but before he does that, not only, when you listen to this song that is going to be played, it's a song of thanks. Thank you for all that they do, but I also want to thank everybody that's ever done anything for the Lord, anybody that's ever given, anybody that's ever told somebody about Jesus. Listen to this song. This is a thank you, and I want to speak some verses over each and every one of you. It's a beautiful song that you've heard our praise team sing, but it's also comes from Numbers 6, verse 24 through 26. It says, "The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace." Eddie, if you'll go ahead and play that song, ushers, you guys can go ahead and start serving the congregation. So I just randomly had music on when I was mowing the yard a couple of weeks ago, and that song came on, and as I thought about all the people that had touched my life, I was like trying to keep it in between the lines of mowing without crying, and absolutely does that remind me of Pastors Dale and Teresa, of how much that they've gave to the Lord, and a lot of people out here in the crowd. I mean, it says a cup of water. If you've given a cup of water. So for everybody that's given, thank you so much. Ushers, if you guys will go ahead and come up here, and if everybody will stand, and please point your hand this way. Father, we love you. We thank you for who you are. We thank you for what you do. We thank you for the people that you've sent here. Father God, we thank you for our pastors, Lord, this morning. We thank you for their blessing, God, that you've put them in our lives, Father God, and that they are the best pastors ever in the world, Lord. We thank you for them. And Lord, we ask that you would anoint this offering this morning, God, that you would send it out into your kingdom to do great and mighty things, Lord. Father, we ask that you would be with this praise team this morning, that you would just usher in your spirit through them, God. And Father, we ask that you would be with Jason as he brings the word, God, that you would just put a fire in his bones, Father God, that he just can't hold in, Father God. Help him, Father God, with every word that he says, God. Help it to come straight from your throne room, Lord. And Father God, help us to receive it, Lord, and not to just, Father God, hear a message and leave it here at the church, God, but to take it out into your world, Father God, and to help build your kingdom, Lord. We love you, we praise you, we thank you for all you do in your name. Amen. Just a couple of quick announcements. First of all, we have kicked off our Connect groups, and if you're not connected with a Connect group, you want more information, there's a bulletin board in the back that you can go and see all the information, but you can go online and you can sign up for a Connect group, and it will send an email to whichever group that you sign up for, and they can contact you with more information. So you need to get connected with somebody. You need to have somebody to help guide our lives. Everybody needs it. I need it. You need it. We all need it. Pastor's got people that he trusts that pour into his life, and we all need that. So please get connected. And the second thing is, we always have prayer meeting. Prayer is so important. Prayer meeting is Thursdays, 10 a.m. If you can at all make it, everybody's welcome here at the church, 10 a.m. And before service on Sunday nights and Wednesday nights, an hour before service prayer meeting. So those are all the announcements I was given. So we're going to go into pastor appreciation. So the first two people I need are you guys. If you could come and stand here, please. So I need Miss Wanda. Go ahead and come up. Tiffany. Keith. Yeah, come on. And RC. Are you? Yeah. You guys look good. Y'all know how many times he's embarrassed me? I'm just kidding. No hard feelings. So, Pastor Appreciation Day, I am your DJ for the morning. And we have some people that would like to share a few things with our pastors. So we're going to start with the kids and go up. So, Miss Wanda.
Okay, I'm going to use your podium for just a little bit here. Okay. For this very special day, we, meaning the Children's Church, we wanted to do something a little different this year, mainly because the video thing just didn't work out. So I thought, well, I'll just ask the kids, what do you think of when I say pastor? When I say Pastor Dale, Pastor Teresa, what is the first thing that pops into your head? So as you can imagine, and congregation, this is like 80% of the responses that I got. One little boy says he ears me. And I'm like, okay, you mean he hears you? He's, no, he ears me. And one little girl says, he sneaks up behind me and tickles me, you know. And someone else said, he taps me and pretends he doesn't, you know. So we all know the characteristics of who we're talking about, you know. And one person said, Miss Teresa always greets me with a smile. And one little girl said, she always tells me I'm pretty every Sunday, you know. And I thought, these answers shows us something about our pastor. He has interaction with even the smallest kids, him and Teresa both. It's not just, you know, us up here that need our help. We need his help with being the shepherd. But even with the kids, even with COVID, all year long, a lot of you guys have no idea what went on behind the scenes. It was every week that he would come to me and Miss Jamie and say, you know, where are we going to have children's church? You know, are they separated? Is this safe? Let's do it outside one more time. You know, he was always concerned. So even though you see him and Teresa up here behind the pulpit, he's still thinking about downstairs and the kids. And so all these answers that I got from the kids, I put in the shape of a thumbprint so you guys can see it. Because God gave you a fingerprint that no one else has, so you can leave an imprint that no one else can. Wow. And you do. Both of you.
Thank you, Miss Wanda. So, we're going to step up in the age groups now. So, Miss Tiffany, are you ready?
Being downstairs with the teenagers, I know for Jimmy and I, can somewhat be a challenge from time to time, but Pastor and Miss Teresa have always fervently had our backs and have always been there for the teenagers and really supported them and helped us be able to guide them as well. I really didn't copy Children's Church. It's just great lines think of my alike. I got you. We got you. It's called God's Thumbprint. And it is scripture out of each book of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. And it's one verse out of the Bible. And we just want to thank you and appreciate you for all that you've done for the teenagers.
All right, so our next group is going to be The Driven, which I will be presenting for. So as I think about all the things that went on this year and over the years, the people that always had our backs were these two people. And I was thinking about things that they give, and they give a lot of things, love. But some of the best things that they've ever given were children. And their kids, and as I've been able to go into The Driven and be a part of that for the last, I don't know, 10 months, I can see those two people in that gentleman right there, because I grew up with him. He was a lot different, but because of them, I can see just how much not only do they care about families, because of their own family, who's they care about our families, they care about your families, they're there no matter what it is, drop of a hat, support, love, and The Driven has did this pumpkin that everybody signed different notes and stuff to you, so thank you so much for all that you do.
Good morning. Can I get the GAP Sunday School class to stand up? Pastor Dale, you and Teresa have been the best pastors I've had in the last 14 and a half years. Of course, they've been the only pastors. But the GAP Sunday School class got together, and we want to tell you how much we love you and we appreciate both of you. Through the hard times, through the good times, you're faithful, you're true, you're just. So, we got you a few different things. In this here, you can open that up. It's a certificate for another stone. It's going to be placed at Friendsville, their hometown, in their honor. And it's going to say on it, Rio East Church, Dale and Teresa, loving pastors. And that's going to be placed here within the next 8 to 10 months, I heard. So it's there for you. Also, in I got it down. Is a card for you, and there's a $100 gift card in there, because you've been talking about getting Miss Teresa a tree. So that's to go towards Miss Teresa's tree. And of course, it's here, detailing equipment. Derek went down and picked it all out. And he told me if I gave you that, you'd probably detail my truck if I brought it over. But we love both of you, and we thank you for your services. Isaiah says, blessed are the feet that carry the word, and blessed are you too. Teresa, I know you're not seen as much as Pastor Dale is, but you're just as much a part of this here ministry and pastorship as he is. We thank both of you.
Thank you so much.
Well, they've got by good, they got by easy. When we started this, when they told us about this, Pastor, we wanted to do something real simple and easy. But they said one of our senior saints in our Sam's Club, senior, said, let's make him work for it. So we've decided, and I want all my seniors, the senior club that was, come on up here, stand. I want you to come up here and stand. Every senior that give anything in this box that's in here, I want you to come up here just for a few. You don't have to stay all the time, but we love our pastor, and he comes to see us on Sunday morning back there, and you know, we have kind of graduated ourselves now, and they've got other leaders, but look at this. And Pastor, we want you to, let's see, Teresa, you stand over here.
Thank you.
So to just simply put it, thank you all. Thank you so much for all that you do, for all that you care, in the good times, the bad times. Everybody here, we love you, and we thank you for all that you do, everything.
Thank you, Grant. I love you too, baby. Thank you so
much. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. To be honest, about 16 years ago when we were asked to be pastors, we said we don't feel like that's our calling. But the Lord changed our calling, and our heart has been placed here in you all. And our family is your family. Your family is our family. And our kids have been engrafted into this church and are as much a part of this church as we are. And so we want to say how much we appreciate each of you this morning. And maybe some of you guys will understand a little bit about how that when we lose someone, either through death or someone chooses to leave our fellowship, that it seems like a piece of us leaves with it. And maybe that might be a little reason why I'm so mean to you sometimes. When I don't see you showing up for church and I lose contact with you, it's because we love you. And we love you from our heart. It's not from our mouth or from words. It's from our heart. We love you. And we want to say how much we appreciate you. All of these things that y'all did are originals. And they'll be cherished and are cherished by us for many years to come. So thank you so much for being a part of the body and the family of Rio East. We love you.
Well, I really don't have the words to express other than how much we love you all. And just like he said, we do. We hurt for you. We hurt for each other when we're going through hard times, and we try to be there, and sometimes we maybe haven't, but we try to. And something that keeps coming to my heart, because it's on my heart this morning, don't take for granted, if you're in Sunday school or who might be pouring into you and mentoring to you, to don't take them for granted. Because yesterday I learned of my elementary Sunday school teacher that I grew up in church. She was my Sunday school teacher that passed away just a few days ago, and she's probably up in her 80s. She didn't even get married until 60 years old because she gave her life to ministry, to serve God. And we had camp meetings where I grew up in the summer on sawdust shavings. And so during the day, the mother, the wives, the women would go down and cook for the people to eat, and the kids had to go tagging along, you know, and she would pour into us with a Bible study during the day. And we got to noticing that she'd go off in the woods. And we thought, where is Trossie going? And we decided to follow her far back and watch her one day. And she had a stump that she went to in the woods. And we would see her knelt down praying. And I know what she's seeing today in heaven. I mean, I don't, but I can imagine what she's seeing. So she was my Sunday school teacher from the time that I started Sunday school. So don't take people for granted. And we want to pour more into you and love on you and just love each other. Thank you.
Thanks, guys. We love you.
Registered in heaven, I've been signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Still the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven, and my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony. Sons and daughters, bought with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father. Our God will finish what He started. Oh, our God will finish what He started. This is my testimony from death to life. Grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. By Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, you're not done. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony from dead to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'll testify. Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story, I'm testified.
Jesus Christ the righteous, I'm justified. This is my testimony, this is my testimony.
We just want to thank you. We want to praise you for who you are. We want to magnify you this morning. We want to lift you up. Lord, it's because of who you are that we're able to stand here today. Lord, that we are able to be in this place today. Lord, that we're able to be in your presence today because of your goodness, because of your grace and your mercy towards us, that we're able to hope for our future. That we're able to wake up and get out of bed every morning, that we're able to know, Lord, who we belong to. We just want to worship you today. Can we just, let's just take a minute right now. Let's just shut off the noise. Shut off the noise of what happened yesterday or what happened this morning on the way to church, what happened is going to happen tomorrow, all those things. Let's just turn that off for a minute. Lord, we want you to have our hearts today. We want you to have our minds today, Lord. Every thought, Lord, may be directed at you. Lord, every desire of our heart may be directed towards you today. Lord, get the stuff that's going on in this world, get it out of the way so that we can focus on you. Lord, that our thoughts and our attention, that our focus, it would be on you today. Because regardless of what's going on around us, Lord, that you are the same. You remain. You stay the same. You're an awesome God that you provide for us. You do all these things that we don't even recognize because we're so used to it. Help us, Lord, to honor you today the way you deserve. We praise you and we thank you for who you are. Thank you.
You call the sun to rise. You lay it down to rest. You hold this heart of mine. You hold my every breath. Such an awesome God, so mighty, so holy, so wonderful. You're such an awesome God, so selfless, so for me.
Jesus, the Son of God. He hung on a cross to die. But not even death itself could hold you back. For you rose to life. Yes, Almighty, so holy, so wonderful. You're such an an awesome God, so
How I need
Like an earthly father does with their children, Lord, you just want to grab us by the hand. Lord, just like we would do if we were walking through a busy parking lot, Lord, that we would grab a hold of our kids and we would make sure, Lord, that they stay close. Lord, may we just grab a hold of your hand today, that you would lead us, Lord, in the safe path, God, that you would lead us in the way that benefits us the most, Lord. God, that we would just be holding right next to you, standing next to you, Lord, that we would walk right beside of where you are, Lord. We thank you. We praise you. You know, it talks about in the Garden of Eden how that God fellowshipped, that he walked with his kids. And that's all he wants from you and from me. He just wants to go on a walk with you. Lord, we just ask, Lord, that you lead us and that you guide us today. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for who you are, Lord. As we go into a time of your word, Lord, please just arrest our minds, that our thoughts would not wander, that our minds would not wander, Lord, but that they would be just set on you, Lord, that they would be set on every word that is spoken on your behalf today. Lord, I ask that you would just minister, Lord, through Jason, and that you use him today. Lord, that you surprise him, Lord, today with the way that you're able to use him, God. That you show him who, reveal to him, God, who he is in you as he speaks today. Lord, that every word, Lord, that is spoken, Lord, that it would just be exactly what we need to hear. That it would just be exactly what you wanted him to present today. Lord, we love you. And we thank you that you love us that much. Lord, that you would prepare a way for us where there doesn't seem to be any way, God, that you do it every time. Thank you. Thank you that you want us, God, that you want to walk with us, that you want to lead us and guide us, Lord. We thank you for, Lord, all that you are. In Jesus' name, amen.
There you go. Father, we come before you, Lord Jesus. We thank you, God. Father, Lord, for this time, God, Lord, that you have showed up, God, in this place, Lord God. Father, Lord, I don't lift Jason up right now, God. Lord, I lift you up,
yes.
Lord God. God, I know that you have already prepared the word that's going to come forth, Lord God. So I pray, God, God, for every heart, God, Lord, that's in this building, God. God, we're living in a day and time, God, when we need you so desperately, God. So, God, I pray, God, that our hearts, Lord God, would be turned to you, Lord Father. That, God, your word would elevate us to a place, God, where we realize, God, that we must decrease, that you would increase in our lives. God, I pray, God, that every word that comes forth,
yes,
Lord God,
Jesus,
that, God, it would set us up, God, yes, in a place in our lives. That, God, that we would understand, God, that we can't walk one day without you. And, Lord, I pray, God, the Holy Spirit would move across this place, God. And God, that you would arrest every heart. That God, that you would bind every spirit. That God, that you would break every chain. That God, that you would cause your word, God, to lift your people up to a place, God, where that we know that there is a God in heaven and that he's on our side. And God, that we can live today, God, know that you have all power. And God, because you live, you said that we can live. And God, I pray, God, that you would move and elevate, God, your word, God, beyond what we have elevated it to, Lord God. Lift us, God, Father, Lord, as we lift you up, Jesus. You said, Lord God, if we lift you up, that you draw all men unto you, Lord. God, use Jason right now, God, as a mouthpiece to proclaim your word, God, that we, the people, Lord God, would walk out of here changed, Lord God, not just 10% change, God, change 100%. Help us, God. We call on you, Lord Jesus. Have your way in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
My goodness. So, give him a hand clap. If you don't have a connect group that you're involved in this afternoon, that's Mr. Claybo. He's going to be bringing the Word of God tonight. If you are, I'll see you at a connect group. But I'm really thankful that I get to, this is like the coolest thing I have ever done in my life. Now, it's the most terrifying thing that I've ever done in my life. Public speaking is the number one fear. How many would like to stand up here and speak right now? Probably not. But I am so honored that given my past and my history, that God would pick somebody like me to deliver his word. And it is in part, and thank you guys, Pastor Appreciation. This is my mom and dad. I want to thank them for everything you've done for me, because I am who I am because of you guys. So thank you all. But as I look out through a crowd, I've been building a gun, and it took me a couple years to build this gun. And I got to try it out yesterday evening. It's an AR-10, 308 caliber. And I saw that gun sitting in my gun safe, and I've looked at it for a couple of years. And I look at that thing, and I think how underutilized this is. It's not complete. It's cool to look at, but it really has no power, because you couldn't put a round in that thing and fire it because it wasn't ready yet. And as I look throughout the crowd and I look throughout God's church right now, I see a bunch of people that are wanting to be used. They're wanting to be mighty. They're wanting to be powerful, but they're lacking that power. And they're lacking the ability. But now you're wanting to. I see soldiers. I see lieutenants and sergeants and captains and generals in God's army. It's not a lack of want to. You just don't know how. And I want to preach about the power of the Holy Spirit this morning through the Lord's help. So, if you've noticed, we live, I don't know what you want to call this year, but I'm going to title this message, The Outbreak. But it's kind of a good title for this year, is The Outbreak. It's been an outbreak this year, an outbreak of evil. However, there's been an outbreak of the Holy Spirit in my life such as I have never experienced. Something's changed. God has been changing my heart. He's changing my family. Things are changing in my life, but I think we all agree there's been an outbreak, right? So let me read something to you. Don't be surprised at this. It's found in 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5, and I will be reading today from the New King James Version. 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5. I hear pages turning. I like that. 2 Timothy 3, 1 through 5. Don't just take my word for it. You read this for yourself. When you get home, you read this, because it will come alive inside of you. It will challenge you and charge you for what you need to be, because the Word of God will correct, approve, reprove, and make something of you that you're not now. But know this, that in the last days, perilous times will come. That doesn't mean like anything that you've ever experienced before. It means perilous. It means unprecedented. It means you're going to see things that you've never seen before. Perilous times will come. For men will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, unloving, unforgiving, slanderers, without self-control, brutal, despisers of good, traitors, headstrong, haughty, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Now, pay attention to this last part. Having a form of godliness, but denying the what? Denying the power. And from such people, turn away. You need to understand the context of this. The context of this was Paul sending a letter to his spiritual son Timothy, and he says, here's what's going to happen in the last days. Now, the context would be this. I expect the world to act like that, don't you? What's sinners do? Yeah, pretty easy. Sinners going to sin. He wasn't talking about sinners. That's a given. We knew that was going to happen. He was talking about inside the church. You're going to start seeing this stuff inside the church. Now, something, hallelujah. Something, man, oh, shoo. Be careful what you pray, Joy. Something just brushed up against me. Whew. Holy Ghost. I don't know if you are expecting, but I'm expecting in here. You want a sum of what's fixing to happen in this place? I'm going to tell you what's unleashed and what you need to do about it. And once you get something inside of you and on the inside of you that starts flowing out, your life is going to change. This is the time for your life to change. It's not time to wait a week from now. It's not time to patty cake around the merry-go-round. It's time to make a difference in God's kingdom now. God has called you now, not tomorrow, not 2 weeks from now, but now to make a decision. I want power. Look at your next door neighbor and say, I need some power. Now look at the other one that may have had bad breath and you didn't favor and say, I need some power. But I believe that not only there's been an outbreak of the virus, I'm going to use that virus against the devil this morning. You guys all right with that? I'm going to use some comparisons and analogies that's going to just shove it right down that loser's throat. I'm tired of him. But not only has there been a viral outbreak, but there's been an outbreak of sin. I mean an outbreak. And if you are going to overcome this outbreak, we want to do something for God, but things try to attack. And I'm not saying possess us. I'm saying they attach themselves to us to where we feel hopeless, helpless. He'll try to screw up in your mind who you think he is and who you think you are. And there's 16 different spirits that I found that are mentioned in the Word of God that have been unleashed. And when I start reading these, I think, my God, not only are they 2 Timothy 3:5, but they're really been unleashed on the world. I mean, how many's ever seen lawlessness like you've seen it here recently? Dear God in heaven, we need something we ain't had before. We need a different level of the Holy Spirit in our lives. Man, there's different, and I'm just picking out a few of them. If you're taking notes, you better pencil in fast. There's a spirit of jealousy that I've seen unleashed on the church. Galatians 5 talks about it. Spirit of lying. Proverbs 31 talks about it. Spirit of bondage, Romans 6, if there's something that you're bound down to and you don't know what it is, this is what it's talking about. It comes against you. You ever felt like, my God, I don't know why I feel the way I do, but this is, I can't kick this. I can't kick this addiction. I can't kick this watching these soap operas or whatever your vice is or spending money. I don't know, but I can't kick this. He says it in here. This is what's been unleashed. A spirit of bondage, a spirit of perversion. Mentioned in 2 Peter chapter 2, spirit of heaviness. Isaiah 61, I'm calling it out, teenagers. There's been a spirit of heaviness that's released on your age group, but I have the power through the Holy Spirit flowing through me to bind it in the name of Jesus. I say to get your hind in and get out of this place, that anybody that's under the covering of this group can't have that spirit of heaviness on them. You start walking laps around your house and realize who you are. I rebuke you in the name of Jesus. Spirit of heaviness. People just feel like down all the time. Hey, you know, you need the spirit of Jesus on you. I'll get there. Spirit of poverty, Matthew chapter 6. And then what we're all seeing right now is the spirit of Antichrist, 1 John chapter 2. Hell, I just want to be cool. I just want to fit in. I just want to go smooth sailing. This is not the day to smooth sail. I know that there have been doom and gloom preachers stand up before that have done long gone and preached hellfire and brimstone and said Jesus is coming back. But But the Bible says that that will have happened, and you will think that in your mind, and you will say, well, it didn't happen for them, it ain't going to happen for me. Don't take your chances, because I have never seen lawlessness released. I've never seen this wickedness in churches, not this one, but in churches, plural, like I have seen it released. He's coming from the inside out. If you want to attack somebody, you put a spy in their country and let them sabotage stuff. That's what he's doing to our families. He's putting in garbage and stuff that don't need to be there and destroying us. So what do I do about it? Say, what do I do about it? We need an out. That wasn't loud enough. What do I do about it? We need an outbreak of the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. I need an outbreak. Now, an outbreak may be different than what some of us, man, my God in heaven. I remember when I was not living for Jesus, and I have to stay up here. Well, no, I don't. I see a cameraman. All right, praise God. I remember when I wasn't so much living for Jesus. And I remember a preacher coming and talking about the power of the Holy Spirit. And you'd always start squirming. And you'd always start fidgeting. And you'd be like, my God, it's supper time. It's 11:49. We need to get out of here. What's going on? Let me tell you what's going on. The Holy Spirit demands change, and He empowers you for that change. And you know that when you leave here, if you experience this, you will not ever be the same again. You know that there's change coming that you've never had in your life. I don't want to be the same. Why am I here? Why am I at church? I'm here to lift up God, but I'm here to change. I want to make a difference when I leave outside of these four walls. Amen? There are people that need to hear the love of Jesus that I have. And if I don't tell them, who's going to? Who else is there at Tate Lyle that's going to tell them except me? But I can't do it under my own power. I need supernatural power. Say supernatural. Supernatural. We need an outbreak of the Holy Spirit. Now to Him, Ephesians 3:20. Now to Him who is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ever ask or think. Stop. We always stop right there. Woo! Boy, He can do exceedingly abundantly above all I could ever ask or think. According to the power that works in us. Yes. What power? The power that I want to introduce you to, and I'm fixing to give you a crash course on the Holy Spirit. We could talk for years on this. And I mean, He is the most awesome. Everybody say He. It's not an it. He is the most awesome. Listen to me. I want to explain something to you. You could take my daughters and my wife and my job and my house away from me, but I say like David says, please, Holy Ghost, please, Lord, do not take your spirit from me, no matter what, because I understand what His power does in my life. I understand what His power has the potential in doing in your life. He can take somebody shy and put them up with a microphone and allow them to preach the Word of God. He can take somebody that's strung out on drugs and sober them up in an instant, in a second, in a blink of an eye. He can do whatever and however He wants to, and don't need your permission to do it. Hallelujah. You got the power to overcome attacks. If you're filled, say filled. Filled with God's Spirit. You cannot be filled and overflowing with God's Holy Spirit and be powerless. You can't. I'm talking to the whiner babies. You cannot be filled and overflowing with the power of the Holy Spirit in your life. Now, you can whine when you get hurt like me. Okay? But you can't whine about something you could pray about and overcome yourself by rebuking and binding and loosing and condemning. You have the power because Jesus paid for you to have that power because that Holy Spirit dwells within you. Say filled. You have the power to overcome the old you. Change the world one person at a time. Overcome all the other spirits that I just mentioned that would come against you and your family. You have authority over these. I so much love it when people call and say, Jason, would you pray? I've got this spirit of heaviness that's come across my family. And I will, but two or more agree on something, it'll be done. I require your attention too. You and I are going to agree on something that thing will leave your household because it takes you. You are the man of the house. We're the men of God in here today. We're the women of God in here today that your husband is not here yet. Say yet. They're not here yet, but because the anointing that's flowing through you and out of you, they will be in this place. I'm prophesying that in the name of Jesus. 1 Corinthians 3:16. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? I want you to understand that you're just a house. Now, hopefully you're a clean house. But nevertheless, you're a house. If something comes against my house right now, and I'm in that house, guess who they're going to have to trifle with? Are they going to have to trifle with the house, or are they going to have to trifle with the owner? That's something that you all need to get through your minds. He said this very clearly. You don't have to worry about the house being protected. If you are infilled with the house, if the owner of the house, which is the Holy Spirit, if I own the house and I'm inside of you and I have filled you, then you won't struggle with depression anymore. You won't struggle with anxiety anymore. You won't struggle with not being who you're called to be through God anymore. You'll be who I called you to be. You'll be who I say you are. If if you are filled with Him. 1 John 4:4. You're of God, little children, and overcome them, because He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. He who is in you is greater than he who is in the world. Another thing, so you have the power to overcome the attacks that's coming against you and your family, but you also have the power to be a witness. Jesus, listen to this. This is important. Jesus, for 3.5 years, taught these dudes that were absolutely useless. But he believed in them. One was a tax. I don't like taxes. He picked two people from the IRS. What's wrong with you, Jesus? And then, have you ever heard the old phrase, cuss like a sailor? Peter, hello, shoot from the hip, cut somebody's ear off. He picked people that nobody else wanted. How many is thankful for that? How many of y'all are thankful that he picked somebody that nobody wanted? So if you're in here today and you feel like nobody wants you, you meet the qualification for Jesus Christ coming into your life and the Holy Spirit absolutely filling you from the bottom to the top. But he picked these people that were society said that they were useless. He taught them for 3.5 years, and then he said, I want you to stay here. I don't want you going anywhere until you're endued with what? With power. He understood that they could not be who they needed to be. No matter, now I poured into you. I've done this. You've come to church. You've been poured into. You know right and wrong. You know how to witness to people. You know you're in love with Jesus. But he said, I want you to stay here till you're endued with this power, because you have to have this. This is me with you, but you don't see me. This is me speaking through you, but you don't see me standing there. Now, when they got that power, the very next thing, Paul preached and thousands were saved. The most misfit of all of them preached the word of God and they were saved. So you are, each one of you all have some super awesome talents in here. Awesome talents. But when that power comes upon you, it supercharges and makes you better at those talents. I remember when, I've always enjoyed teaching people. And I remember when they asked me, they said, Jason, you need to put in for this safety coordinator job. And I said, God, I can't do this. I can't do this. And how many of y'all have said that? I can't be a Sunday school teacher. I can't be a door greeter. I don't even like to smile, Lord, sometimes. Well, God will fix that. But I was running this thing through my mind while I couldn't do this. And all of a sudden, I was speaking in English in the bathroom. That's my quiet place at work, is the bathroom. I got a special one picked out. It's away from everybody. And I'm sure people have come in there and thought, my God, in heaven, stalls shaking, people speaking, what's going on in here? But I was speaking in English, and all of a sudden it started coming out in tongues. This was right before I went into the bath, or right before I went into the interview. And I remember going into that interview, saying this, God, in my weakness, you're going to be made strong. And I did that presentation, and I did an earthly presentation under the power of the Holy Spirit. Is that possible? Yes, it is. Is it possible to be a businessman and get people come to you and want to do transactions and want to do business with you? Yes, the Holy Spirit will attract them. He'll cause you to be better at what you do now. If you're the type of person who likes to sing, He'll cause anointing to flow out of your mouth when you start to sing instead of just a shower singer. Like me, He'll make something of you that you are not. I remember when God uses me in awesome ways, and some of you all, and I look and I say, man, I need the Holy Spirit, but I've also tried to do something on my own. Who's ever tried to do something on their own and stand up and do something in front of people and just absolutely fall on your face? He don't need your help. We need His help. I don't work for the... I don't know how to get this right. I want to say this correctly. The Holy Spirit is not
somebody that, let me give you a good illustration. Let me read this verse before. John 20:21-22. So Jesus said to them again, "Peace to you. As the Father has sent me, I also send you." And when he has said this, he breathed on them. Didn't nobody tell Jesus you ain't supposed to do that without a mask on? And he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now you got to understand this. I'm already sweating. He breathed on them. Why did they not receive the Holy Spirit? This, I'll tell you the timing. Thomas was fixing to walk in, and he was fixing to show Thomas his scars. So he had already died on the cross, had already risen and showed himself to several, but was still waiting on Thomas. Why did he blow on them? Jesus, you don't supposed to do that. Because when you do that, it infects people with something. Right? What he was doing was at the moment of salvation, this is the illustration he's given. At the moment of salvation, you receive the Holy Spirit. At the moment you ask, you're filled with the Holy Spirit. Let me get this straight. There are people that carry MRSA, and there are people that carry chicken pox around. Are you catching me? And they don't know it, but every now and then, that virus that's inside of them, that thing that's inside of them that becomes stronger than their flesh, will start manifesting itself through them. And when it starts manifesting through them, it overpowers their flesh. Then they're filled with that, and they have their sickness. It's the same way with COVID. It's the same way with MRSA or the chicken pox. When you get an overload of that in you, it takes over your flesh. So when you get saved, where's Jesus at right now? And the little kids would say, "Well, he's in my heart." Not really. He's at the right hand of the Father making intercessory prayer for the saints. Who is inside of you right now? When you get saved, listen to me, you got to catch this, because when you catch this, it'll liberate you. And you'll be able to explain it to your coworkers. It says that when I get saved, I receive. But there's a difference in being received something and being filled with something. Because if my flesh overruns what I received, it will never manifest itself. If my flesh, now here's what we like to do. This is Jesus. This baby's got 12 volts in it. 12 volt battery. It's heated. Holy Ghost. You're the comforter. Thank you that you're my rock and my shield, my salvation, the armor that's on side of me. I can do whatever. I know who I am in Christ. You hear me? I know who I am in Christ. And I can even change the levels. I may want to get more intimate with him. Whew, we'll turn her white. And it turns the heat up a little more. And then if I want some more, I'm on blue. And I can get some real heat out of this baby. And that's the way we feel like the Holy Spirit. Are you spirit-filled? Yes, I go to a Pentecostal church. Let me tell you something. I can speak some Spanish words, but that does not mean I am fluent in Spanish. Are you understanding? There's some of us that have, I can say some tongues, but that don't mean I'm speaking in tongues. Because there's going to be something that comes out of you. There's going to be a difference once you're filled. Now, what I'm saying is this ain't going to cause no difference inside of me. It's comfort. You get what I'm saying? Now, please don't say that Jason compared the Holy Ghost to this. Now, this is joy. This is how joy keeps Jason in line. But I remember one time walking through Tractor Supply, and I was with some friends. And these friends thought it would be funny to take a cattle prong. And I'm talking about one of the ones that has some heat to it. And they stuck that to me. And the next thing I know is I woke up and I had peed on myself. And I was laying on, there wasn't nobody around. I didn't even know what had happened. So the difference in you being receiving the Holy Spirit, he's your comfort, he's your guide, he's the counselor. He's there to tell you who you are. He's there to lead you. He's there to guide you. But then there's this thing that when you're filled with the Holy Spirit, that once you get nailed with that, something's going to change. Something's going to change. It's a power that overpowers your flesh. Are you hearing me? It's like when you're, and you know what? Everybody around you is going to change too. Because now, my God, the people that's sleeping in here are wide awake. when the Lord starts, the Holy Spirit starts filling you, your speech is going to change. Everything about you, and I'm going to try not to get it, stick it back in here, but everything about you will absolutely change. How do I know if I'm filled with the Spirit? Ask your wife. Ask your husband. They're going to tell you something about him has changed. He's not the same old person. He don't look the same things he used to look at. And he don't talk about the same things he used to talk about. Say, what do I do? We got to have practical application. Because here's what happens. We come in this church and we get absolutely filled to the brim with the Holy Spirit. And then we leave out of here and that's it. How do I stay filled? How do I stay filled that when I walk through my work, people come up to me and say, man, I got this. I want what you got. My wife left me and I want this Jesus because I'm so empty. How do I keep filled? Oh, let me get back to my notes. Galatians 5, 22 and 23. That's one of them. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, I was going to say fruitfulness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. You, nowhere in there did I hear the fruit of the Spirit is speaking in tongues. Nowhere did I, now that's good. That's much needed. But here's what we do. We say it's all about speaking in tongues. It's all about feeling something. And what we do, because we're so lonely and miserable, because we don't have this power that God has said that we could have, is we want God to rock our world, and we come to this altar and we're after an emotional experience. That's all we're after. Because we have no intent on changing anything, making anything new, or talking to anybody we never talked about for Jesus. Remember, they spent 3.5 years with him and then tarried there so they could be endued with power to do what they couldn't do on their own. So, let's find out what we need to do to maintain the power of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And I promise, will you guys give me 7 minutes? I'll be done with this in 7 minutes, but this could change your life forever. Quit worrying about what time it is. Acts, first off, Luke 24, 49. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you're endued with power from on high. Acts chapter 2, verse 1 through 4. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were in one accord in one place. That's not a Honda Accord. That means they were in one mindset. They had one passion. Okay? On the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were in one accord, one passion, and suddenly, say suddenly, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each one of them. And they were all filled with, say all. It didn't matter if you were little, tall, fat, small, bald, hairy, or smelly. Every one of them got it. I word of God, every one of us in here today, be filled. This is not a condemning message. This is me saying Christmas time, ladies and gentlemen, come get it, because God wants to give it to you. He don't want you to keep being weak-minded and feeble and not being able to do anything for him. He says, come on to me, all who are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Be filled with the Holy Spirit in Jesus' name. So there's three keys to an outbreak. What do I do when I leave here tomorrow morning? How do I keep being Spirit-filled after I come up here and I become Spirit-filled here in just a second? First off, is they had a passion for Jesus. The disciples were in one accord and they were in one place. They didn't know a thing about talking in tongues. They didn't know what was fixing to happen. Wouldn't it be cool if Jesus had said, here, I want you to stay right here. I want you to do this. Here's what's going on. My Jesus don't work like that. I don't know if yours does. Mine don't work like that. He's asking me to walk with him. Every day, hold his hand and walk with him. And he said, I want you to be passionate about me. So they were up in the upper room. They had one mind and one accord, which meant they were extremely passionate about Jesus. Don't be passionate about speaking up in tongues and coming to this altar. Don't do it. Don't be passionate about rolling around on the ground, because what we do is we'll stand up here and we'll look at people and we'll say, oh, she's crying. She must be powerful. Praise God. No, maybe she's just sad. You know? Oh, man, they just fell on the ground. Are they going to be any different when they get back up? That's the Holy Spirit that I'm talking about. But we have a passion for the manifestation, but not a passion for Jesus. They didn't know what was fixing to happen. They didn't know what firestorm was fixing to erupt up in that place. All they knew was they had a passion for Jesus. They wanted him more than anything. When was the last time your passion at home was just Jesus? And not just all the sports, not just all this going on, not just, you want to keep on fire and the Holy Spirit flowing out of you, you make your passion Jesus, and he'll fill you up and blow you out on everybody else. Or you can be passionate about the next vehicle, passionate about chasing after him or her, passionate about the job, because he said, I will have no other gods before me. You have to be passionate. Second thing, when I saw these teenagers up here praying this morning, that was a breath of fresh air. They were excited. They were excited. You got to have excitement. Passion and excitement. Do you remember that one Sunday that you all saw a guy prophesy? What happened? It got you excited. I'm going to tell you something. Excitement will draw out the anointing of the man of God. If there's somebody sitting in here rocking back and forth, it'll suck the life out of me. I'll give it everything I absolutely have. And when Jesus says, hey, when people are excited about me, I am going to show up. When's the last time we come in here and wasn't looking for a concert, wasn't looking for the right song to minister to us, wasn't looking for Joy to do the right thing or the man of God preach a word that wasn't condemning, but we come in here expecting to be changed, expecting for our household to be delivered, expecting the evil in this place to be cast out. When was the last time we come with a little bit of excitement? And I'll say my favorite thing. You might want to notify a part of your body. Now, the Holy Spirit ain't the same for everybody. If I hit you with this 40 billion volt taser, some of you might, whoa, you know, and then some of you just might fall down, and some of you may not make a noise. I'm not worried about what you look like when it happens. I'm worried about what happens tomorrow, the change that takes place. Are you hearing me? Stop getting hung up. If nothing squalling happens and you stand here like a brick, but you go out tomorrow and business deals start happening, you're empowered, God gives you. You know what happened to Samson when he got the power of the Holy Spirit hit him? He got what? What happened when Elijah saw the cloud? He outran a horse. He got some strength. My God, when the Spirit of God hit him. What if you got some wisdom like Solomon when the Spirit of God hit him and you went out and you made some better choices for once in your life? Who cares if you squall or cry? I cry. That's why I'm making fun of it. Who cares? That's not what matters. What matters is if you're full of him and filled with him and you do something different. So we've got passionate and we've got, woo, do that. Come on, I'm about to lose my voice. Woo! You're excited. And then the last one is you're obedient. You're like, oh my God. Jason, you just ruined it. Passionate, woo, thank you, Jesus. Excited, Holy Ghost. Obedient, oh, time to go home. Well, remember, they had no clue what was fixing to happen. I would have been like, so what are we supposed to do now? We're supposed to eat. Brent, call Heather, get some food here. We got to get some food here. Are we supposed to stand up? Are we supposed to sit down? Are we supposed to pray? Are we supposed to lift our hands? Am I supposed to scream? Am I supposed to shout? Am I supposed to worship? What am I supposed to do now? And one of them said, Jason, shut up. Just sit here and tarry. Shut up. Just sit here and think about Jesus and how awesome he is and why he took our place. They didn't know a thing. Why don't you come up here with ignorance in your mind saying, Jesus, I just want you. I am expecting something to happen. I am passionate after you, and I'm going to be obedient. In other words, I'm going to start doing the things that you've been telling me not to do. I'm going to start not doing them. I'm going to start forgiving people. Why do we not leave out of here and the Spirit of God pour through us? Because he fills us up and overloads the flesh. But then when we walk out of here, we have unforgiveness that suppresses him back down towards somebody because they didn't say the right thing. They didn't shake my hand. They didn't use hand sanitizer. What's God telling you to do? What kind of obedience do you need to start using in your life? Because I'm going to tell you something. How many were in the upper room? 120. Everybody stand up in here. Eddie, go ahead. There were 120, and God told me to tell you about the five. Because I'm pretty sure there were 125. I know the Bible doesn't say it, but I don't want you to be one of the five in here either. There were five who were told to stay and tarry, but they just couldn't. They had family. They had Thanksgiving coming. They had all this other stuff. They couldn't pray. I have an expectancy. God is fixing to do something in this church. I don't know what, but don't really care as long as he's doing it. I have an expectancy in my family. Something mighty is fixing to happen. I have an expectancy over each one of y'all's lives, but there's something you have to understand. There was five that were there that left before God could pour out on them. There were five that were there that said, you know what, this just ain't for me. And I hope not. But there could be five in here that says, you know what, I don't care. I just want to live for Jesus. But your teenager ain't going to make it if you don't get endowed with something. Teenagers, you're going to turn the world upside down. You have something that's instilled in your DNA. Let me talk to you for just a second. You have the ability to worship and get in the throne room in like 0 to 60. Presence of God flowing all over the place. But one of you all could leave here, right? And you need this power. You need this power. Your parents don't need to be the one casting out devils. You do. Your family doesn't need to be one saying, Daddy, will you pray for me? You're going to be praying for Daddy coming up. You're going to be praying for Mama coming up. I know you're in a messed up situation, but you were strategically placed there. It wasn't an accident. Strategically. But who in here is going to be one of the five that says, I don't want this. I'm going to leave, and you're going to miss out on this awesome outpouring of God with every head bowed and every eye closed in here. I'm fixing to open up this altar to people that want to be filled with the Holy Spirit. You may be in here and you lost your passion. You need to get saved again. There ain't no passion. There ain't no Holy Spirit flowing out of you. Yeah, I was Spirit-filled. It's time to get re-Spirit-filled. But you know I'm talking to you right now. But I want to give another altar call for people in here that, man, you're doing the best you can, but you can't stay off of drugs. You can't stay off of pornography. You can't stay off of yourself. You're addicted to yourself. I know. I was addicted to myself. You say, Jason, I need that first step, and that's being receiving the Holy Spirit through salvation from Jesus Christ, that I admit I'm a sinner and I need to be saved and I want something I do not have. I've tried everything else with every head bowed and eye closed in here. If that's you and you say, I want this Jesus, I want to be excited like you, I want to be on fire like you, and I want to be used like you. If that's you, I want you to lift your hand in here right now in the name of Jesus. Hands going up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You're not a minority. You're not alone in this place. You know what Jesus is doing? He is so excited. He said, oh my God, the party that's fixing to break out in heaven. So here's what I want you to do. I want everybody in here. Now, the people that lifted your hand, you're also going to get to come up here to this altar call. I'll say, Jesus, everybody. Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins. Thank you for taking my place. Thank you for dying for my sins. I'm asking you from this day on that you let my life be a sacrifice to you. I want you to live inside of me. And I want my flesh to die every day. And I'm an overcomer through you. In Jesus' name. Now, if you're in here and you want to be filled, not received, you just received. If you want to be filled with the Holy Spirit where it overpowers your flesh, something rises up in you and you're different from the way you used to be, I want you to flood these altars and get ready. Stop looking at who's around you. Stop paying attention to what's going on. If I have to stay here all day with you, I will. But you're going to be filled. But it may not look like what you think it's going to look like. It may not feel like what you think it's going to feel like. Why? Because the Holy Spirit's a gentleman. Who else? What I'm doing ain't working, and I've got to have more. I want to be filled. I want to be filled. Now listen. Don't be surprised if I don't come up to you and tell you to stand up and lift your hands up. Because he really likes it when people worship him that want to be filled. He really likes it when people that want something different than what they've had. When I said what I said towards the teenagers, I can't leave it. There is power that you all need to overcome the enemy that you will never be able to do by yourself. I'm talking to younger people in here right now and older people, but I'm focusing in on the younger people because that spirit of heaviness has tried to defeat you. But guess what? You're like, man, I suck at life. You are doing a great job. You're rocking it. Why? Because you're here. You're not as bad as you thought you were. You're in this church and you're here. And this is your opportunity. And God says, I pick you. I choose you. I'll walk straight past every person that's got Genesis to Revelations memorized and come after the sinner. I want you so much. I want you so bad. I'm going to count to seven. One. Two. Don't stop. Three. I want Jesus and I want to be filled. Four. Five. Who else? Go ahead and turn it up, Eddie. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Altar workers, I want you to help me come pray. If you're spirit-filled, if you've got the fruits of the Spirit running through your life and you want to be filled more than you ever have, I want you to pick somebody and don't hopscotch.